baru ini muncul. Banyak sekali inovasi-inovasi baru ini muncul dalam selama proses belajar dari rumah yang dilakukan oleh Bapak Ibu guru semua. Kita bisa melihat di lapangan tentunya, karena banyak sekali di sini adalah para pendidik yang hadir. Sebagian besar dari guru-guru kita itu kemudian ada yang memanfaatkan media daring. Nah, itu beberapa portal yang sudah direkomendasikan oleh teman-teman pendidikan, karena di ini banyak sekali portal yang bisa diakses untuk melaksanakan proses belajar mengajar daring ini, ataupun memanfaatkan semua media yang dirasa paling mudah dan applicable untuk tetap bisa berkomunikasi dengan peserta didiknya. Dari paling sederhana, misalnya kita menggunakan WhatsApp misalnya, atau nanti messenger yang lain, atau sampai yang paling sulit kita menggunakan sebuah learning management system yang terintegrasi, sehingga ada proses aktiviti pembelajaran yang itu dilakukan secara lebih kompleks kira-kira begitu. Nah, ini tentu banyak sekali pilihan-pilihan yang tentunya sudah dilakukan oleh para peserta didik kita. Namun, di sisi lain, kita juga menyadari betul bahwa tidak semua titik di Indonesia itu coverage internet areanya bagus, Mas Indra dan teman-teman semua. Jadi, dari data yang saya catat ya, dari Kementerian Kominfo, dari sekitar 83.218 desa dan kecamatan di seluruh Indonesia yang di cover oleh 4G itu paling, ini data dari akhir tahun 2019 itu hanya sekitar 73.7%, yang tercover 3G sekitar 80%, dan yang sisanya 90% ke atas itu baru lagi. Nah, ini tentu kan menjadi sebuah PR besar dan buat kita selama pandemi COVID ini, karena negara harus hadir untuk semua warga negaranya. Kita tidak mungkin hanya berpihak kepada Jakarta, Surabaya, Semarang, Medan, Bali, gitu ya, atau kota-kota besar yang lain. Kita harus mengingat bahwa kita masih punya Sangihe dan Pulau Rote, kita masih punya Miangas, kita masih punya Sampang, dan kita masih punya Larantuka, daerah-daerah mungkin, dan terutama di kepulauan, yang mereka memiliki keterbatasan-keterbatasan akses tidak sebagaimana di kota-kota besar. Nah, di titik ini akhirnya dari Kementerian Pendidikan dan Kebudayaan memberikan sebuah solusi proses belajar mengajar menggunakan siaran televisi yang sebagaimana teman-teman guru semua bisa saksikan di rumah masing-masing. Jadi ada mata pelajaran yang kemudian di-deliver menggunakan TVRI sebagai apa namanya channelnya. Kenapa kemudian kita pakai TV? Karena jujur saja persoalan jangkauan, persoalan akses yang murah, persoalan koneksi yang itu juga tidak menuntut kos yang mahal karena faktor kuota, dan itu gratis, dan tinggal nanti Bapak Ibu guru menyesuaikan dengan skema proses mengajar yang ada di sekolah masing-masing. Tentu ada plus minus dari semuanya itu ya. Internet mungkin lebih bagus dari sisi kolaborasi, dari sisi komunikasi arah. TV mungkin terbatas hanya komunikasi satu arah, tapi sekali lagi kita melakukan pendekatan-pendekatan ini sangat menyesuaikan dengan konteks yang ada di masing-masing daerah. Kalau internetnya bagus ya monggo silahkan pakai koneksi. Kalau kemudian internetnya saya pikir sulit positioningnya kira-kira gitu, kita menggunakan TVRI sebagai sarana proses belajar mengajar kita. Dan yang menarik Mas Indra, saya perlu sampaikan semua kepada rekan-rekan sekalian bahwa hasil survei yang kita lakukan terhadap proses belajar mengajar di TVRI ini, lebih dari 99% orang di Indonesia itu tahu bahwa ada program belajar dari rumah ini, dan mereka menonton itu. Dan tingkat kepuasan terhadap proses penyelenggaraan belajar dari rumah ini di atas 7 dengan skala 10. Artinya publik, masyarakat memang mengerti betul dan memanfaatkan betul proses konten-konten yang diberikan menggunakan TVN ini sebagai sebuah sarana untuk mengajar untuk adik-adik kita dan peserta didik. Namun demikian, kami juga sangat menghargai inisiasi-inisiasi yang dilakukan oleh para individu-individu dan komunitas-komunitas belajar yang lain. Ada satu case yang kemarin sempat viral di media online ya. Ada salah satu guru di Madura di mana karena keterbatasan muridnya itu dia tidak bisa menggunakan teknologi. Dan itu dia lakukan adalah mengajar dari rumah ke rumah. Dia berputar dari satu siswanya ke siswa yang lain karena keterbatasan siswanya yang tidak memiliki kemampuan. Dia kemudian menggunakan apa namanya proses belajar mengajar secara kertas yang kemudian dideliver, dan kemudian dia datang di waktu yang lain untuk melakukan atau ngecek kembali apakah aktivitas yang dilakukan itu sudah berjalan dengan baik atau belum. Ada teman-teman juga yang secara individual kemudian atau secara kolaboratif itu memanfaatkan siaran radio. Nah, apapun bentuknya, apapun ikhtiarnya, saya pikir ini menjadi menarik untuk kemudian mengamati bahwa memang kreativitas itu biasanya lahir dalam situasi yang sangat sulit. Ini kadang-kadang saya optimisnya dengan bangsa Indonesia itu begini nih. Kreativitas itu pasti akan lahir dalam situasi yang sangat sulit, dan kami dari Kementerian dan Kebudayaan sangat mengapresiasi proses yang demikian itu. Nah, sebagai sebuah upaya supporting terhadap aktivitas yang tadi dilakukan selama masa pandemi ini, pemerintah saya pikir juga sudah fleksibel, terutama terkait dengan tata kelola dan manajemen yang ada di sekolah masing-masing. Oleh karenanya, Mas Menteri dalam hal ini sudah merevisi Permendagri POS untuk bisa diizinkan alokasinya untuk kuota internet, kira-kira gitu, yang hari ini kebutuhan primer selama proses pandemi kali ini. Kalau dulu, hal-hal yang sifatnya IT, sifatnya digital, sifatnya semacam itu, sifatnya secondary, semuanya berubah menjadi primer. Semua berubah menjadi seakan-akan wajib karena sekali lagi situasi kondisi yang memaksa. Nah, oleh karena itu, regulasi terkait dengan Permendagri POS ini dikeluarkan supaya sekolah lebih memiliki fleksibilitas pada saat melakukan tata kelola di satuan pendidikannya masing-masing. Plus kami dari Kementerian Pendidikan juga bekerjasama dengan beberapa provider tentunya untuk memberikan akses kuota kepada para bapak ibu guru semua pada saat mengakses. Maksudnya kita bekerja dengan provider itu menggratiskan beberapa layanan selama untuk mengakses konten-konten pendidikan atau laman-laman pendidikan yang ada di, contohnya ya, yang ada di rumah belajar, ada di ruang guru, ada di rumah guru, ada di beberapa laman-laman pendidikan yang lain sebagai sebuah bentuk ikhtiar terhadap pandemi masa COVID kali ini. Nah, yang kita butuhkan saya pikir pada titik ini saat kita bicara new normal nanti, bahasanya orang-orang sekarang begitu, atau kenormalan baru atau kelaziman baru suatu saat gitu ya, setelah ini yang justru kita butuhkan adalah persoalan global solidarity. Saya pikir forum ini menjadi menarik nanti diskusinya, kita bincang secara bersama-sama, berbagi praktik baik antara yang satu daerah yang lainnya, juga hadir sudah Julie dari Arizona State University yang mungkin juga akan sharing best practice bagaimana menghadapi pandemi COVID di US posisinya atau di mungkin beberapa case negara-negara yang lain, untuk kita bisa saling belajar bersama dan kita melakukan global solidarity, bagaimana kemudian kita bisa keluar secara bersama-sama dari situasi kayak begini dengan baik dan tetap proses pendidikan adik-adik kita bisa terjaga. Dan informasi terakhir saya pikir yang saya ingin share kepada rekan-rekan guru sekalian yang hadir pada kesempatan diskusi kali ini, Mas Menteri kemarin sudah mengeluarkan satu informasi terkait masuk sekolah ya. Saya pikir rekan-rekan guru sekalian sudah membaca juga. Jadi Kemdikbud hari ini menilai bahwa belum diperlukan perubahan tahun ajaran baru maupun tahun akademik. Hanya metode belajarnya saja yang mungkin sangat menyesuaikan dengan pertimbangan kondisi yang ada di masing-masing wilayah, yang tentunya itu sangat ditentukan oleh tim gugus tugas di tempat tersebut. Jadi insya Allah tahun ajarannya tidak berubah, tahun akademiknya tidak berubah, tapi pola belajarnya, artinya urusannya dengan masuk sekolah gitu ya, kemudian nanti social distancing, physical distancing yang itu akan terjadi di lapangan, dan itu sangat tergantung dengan rekomendasi dan pertimbangan dari tim gugus tugas yang berada di daerah masing-masing. Dan saya pikir sebagai sebuah penutup pada sambutan kali ini, saya ingin betul yang disampaikan Arun Dadiroy dalam sebuah sesi tulisan beliau di April 2020 ini, dia menyampaikan kasus ini, pandemi COVID-19 ini, it is a portal. It's a gateway between one world and the next world. Jadi kita memasuki gerbang baru. Kita kemudian seakan-akan melompat dengan situasi ini dari situasi yang kemarin ke situasi yang berikutnya, dan tentu tidak nyaman saya pikir buat semuanya. Karena dalam proses perubahan pasti tidak ada unsur ketidaknyamanan di situ yang menjadi sebuah efek atau sebuah akibat dari hal-hal yang terjadi. Namun saya yakin, saya optimis bahwa kita bangsa Indonesia, lebih khusus lagi dalam komunitas pendidikan yang hari ini berkecimpung di situ, mampu mengarungi itu semua dengan baik, mampu keluar dari krisis ini dengan baik, tentunya juga dengan kerja barengan, dengan solidaritas global yang tadi kita usung secara bersama-sama. Insya Allah masa depan itu masih terang di depan kita. Saya pikir itu yang bisa saya sampaikan, Mas Indra, kepada rekan-rekan semua pada saat diskusi kali ini. Sekali lagi selamat berdiskusi pada kesempatan siang hari ini. Pusdatin mensupport penuh apapun yang menjadi ikhtiar dan kewenangan sebagai sebuah bentuk solidaritas global pada saat pandemi COVID-19. Demikian, terima kasih, selamat pagi. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih Pak Hasan dan Bibi atas sambutan dan keynote-nya. Ya, banyak hal yang memang kita pelajari dalam kondisi pandemi COVID-19 ini. Mudah-mudahan kita bisa mendapatkan banyak ilmu dari Julia yang hari ini yang akan share dengan kita semua. Bapak-Ibu sekalian, untuk mempersingkat waktu, saya akan segera memulai paparan sharing dari Julian. Sedikit saja background beliau. Beliau ini sekarang menjabat sebagai wakil rektor Arizona State University Amerika Serikat, sebuah perguruan tinggi negeri yang menempati posisi 1% perguruan tinggi terbaik dunia dan nomor 1 urusan inovasi. Julian juga menjabat sebagai Managing Director daripada ASU Prep dan ASU Prep Digital. Ini adalah lab school-nya Arizona State University. Nah, Julian ini punya pengalaman sebagai tokoh pertama yang mendesain sekolah virtual di dunia, yaitu Florida Virtual School, dan sudah lebih dari 50 juta siswa yang ikut program ini di 68 negara. Oke, okay, so untuk mempersingkat waktu akan kita segera mulai saja. Good evening, Julie. You just go ahead, start and share your experience, your knowledge, your wisdom. We are here all to hear that. So,
all right.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Indra. And I just want to say hello to all the Indonesia's educators and good evening from Florida. It is about 9:30 in the evening here, so I'm getting my second wind to be with you all tonight. And I am incredibly pleased to be with you for this historical event. So my name is Julie Young, as Indra said. I have been, tell you a little bit about myself, not knowing what Indra said, but a little about myself. I have been an educator for 40 years, and I have been a digital educator for the last 25. I had a unique opportunity back in 1997 to start what is known as FLVS Now. It was Florida Virtual School before, which was the very first statewide, legislatively created public virtual school. And for those of you who were around then, that was back in the age of dial-up. If you think about 1996, 1997, that was about the time that they said the internet was invented. So I've been doing this for quite a while. Florida Virtual School started out with 77 students in 1997. And when I retired from Florida Education in 2014, we had about 650,000 enrollments in the state of Florida, about 350 students we were serving. and we were working and serving all 50 states in the United States and 68 countries around the world, touching about 2 million learners. So, yeah, we've come a long way. And when we think about where we are today in the midst of this world pandemic crisis, it seems like I have spent my whole career planning for this day. So thank you for having me with you, and I'll share a few stories tonight and a little bit about the work that I have had the opportunity to do. And let's see here. Not sure why this is not going. Here we go. All right, so tonight we're actually going to spend some time talking a little bit about the history of distance learning. Not a lot about the history, but a little bit about the history. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about how digital education has developed over the years, what I think the future of education is going to look like, and the globalization of education. So where have we been? So the University of London, supposedly, if you actually look at the history, there's a debate about whether the University of London actually was the first university in the world to offer full degrees through distance learning. The University of Chicago actually thinks they were in 1892. But I think it's important to note that a long time ago, our education institutions started working with distance learning to provide flexibility to its students. 1922, Penn State in the US, the first college to broadcast courses over the radio for distance learning. And then of course, as it advanced in 1960, University of Illinois, or actually I missed the bottom one, the University of Houston started offering courses on television. And I think many of us remember the radio shows. I actually still remember some radio shows that my family listened to, but I definitely remember the TV education shows. And then in 1960, interestingly enough, many years before the quote-unquote internet was developed, the University of Illinois created what is known as an intranet system within their university to start putting course materials out and lectures out for its students so that they could access those lectures and those course materials from remote locations. 1976, in Southern California, we had the first virtual campus, Coastline Community College, still existing today. 1985 was the first accredited online graduate program, and I remember when that program started at Nova Southeastern University, which is in the state of Florida. And then, of course, what I'm very proud of is 1997, the first legislatively endorsed statewide public virtual school was established as Florida Virtual School. So fast forward to where I am today. And as Indra said, I have the privilege of being the managing director for ASU Prep Digital at Arizona State University, which is known and identified as the most innovative university in the United States. It is the largest university in the United States, with over 45,000 online learners on a regular basis. Now, when you add our campus-based students who have all seamlessly transitioned to online learning in the last 3 months, then we have approximately 130,000 students that are actually learning online at the university. ASU Prep Digital is part of what is known as ASU Prep Academy. And in the United States, that is a network of charter schools, which are choice schools, that was authorized by the university about 10 years ago. We have 12 schools. 11 of those schools are brick and mortar schools and house approximately 3,200 individual students. The digital school is the 12th school, and it underpins all of our brick and mortar schools. And we exist for two reasons. One is to improve educational outcomes for all of the students we serve in our community and we see the world as our community. Number two, to create new education models for success and then take those out to scale again in our community, which we see as the world. We have this really unique ecosystem within ASU Prep Academy because those 12 schools actually represent almost every socioeconomic level that you could think of in the United States. We have one school that is in the lowest socioeconomic or highest poverty zip code in the state. And then we have the other end of the spectrum where we have a STEM school, a K-12 STEM school, that sits on our polytechnic campus. We have a rural school that sits on and next to and one of our American Indian reservations. We also have a small little school in downtown Tempe. And then we have an urban school in downtown Phoenix, which was our first school, which was a turnaround school at the time 10 years ago. So as you can see, we have this really unique opportunity within ASU to actually learn a great deal about K-12 education within our university institution. And what we hope to do and what we have been doing is creating this continuum of learning where students can come in anywhere as a learner, whether they are 4 or whether they are 94. And there will be a place for them to learn at Arizona State University. So a little bit about the backdrop. If we think about where we've been and then where we are now. And this pictorial here kind of demonstrates all the different types of programs that exist today. We have district programs, state programs, multi-state programs, national programs, and certainly global programs. ASU Prep Digital serves the globe. We not only serve our Arizona State, in our Arizona State, our students there, but we are serving students nationally and internationally around the globe. One of the things that we really hope to accomplish is we really want to connect our students around the globe to each other so they have the opportunity to be together in classes and learn from each other and really discover diversity in our world firsthand together. We have part-time programs in our world, in our country, where kids are taking one or two courses at a time or just taking summer school online. And then we have full-time schools. ASU Prep Digital has a full-time school and a part-time program. We have asynchronous learning taking place in our online programs, and then we have synchronous programs that are taking place, like we are doing right now. And so as we think about all the different ways that we are now serving our students in online environments, it's vast. There are many, many opportunities for our families and our students now to work digitally, truly worldwide. So why are we here? So it's kind of funny. I'll kind of take you back to when Florida Virtual School started, when I started my digital career. And at that time, no one really knew what virtual learning was. Certainly no one saw a reason to have it at the K-12 level. There were certainly some university programs, as we have already established. But at the K-12 level, people were kind of like, why would we do this? And how could this be a good way for students to learn? So we spent a lot of time trying to prove ourselves. And as we looked at how we created the model at that time, our goal was to create a learning experience for our students which was truly focused on putting the student at the center of every decision that we made. We were given the opportunity by the state of Florida, by our legislature and our leadership, and by our governor, Governor Bush at the time, to make it up as we went along and to come back and tell them how we thought it should be done. It gave us an opportunity to just start with a completely fresh slate and truly think about if we were going to design a program, if we were going to reinvent education, putting that student at the center of all our decisions, what would change? And we quickly learned that almost everything would change. How students learned in terms of eliminating the calendar, eliminating start and end times during the day, eliminating start and end times for classes. Students could work at their own pace. Kids who were ready could move faster. Kids who needed more time could take more time without being penalized. The goal was mastery, and the goal was we wanted to evaluate ourselves and our students by what they knew when they left us, not what they didn't know while they were with us. And if you think about how we grade our students pretty much all over the world, we grade them on what they don't know while they're with us, as opposed to what they have learned when they leave us. So our focus was, we wanted every student to master the content before they left us, and we had that opportunity. So why are we here? Well, there's 10 drivers of blended learning that you see on the screen right now. And just to think about a little bit, you know, where we are right now is we're hyper-focused on how we personalize learning for our students in the United States, and I think worldwide. We have come to learn that students are all different. All of us are different. We learn differently. And so why would we be in this same pace, same time, same room scenario and expect for our students to all learn at their highest level? I heard an analogy today on a podcast that I thought was awesome. The analogy was that if you were a basketball player, and I'm from originally Kentucky, so if any of you know anything about the United States basketball, that's a big basketball state, so I like this analogy. But if you are a basketball player and you are trying to improve your free throws, well, what are you going to do? You're going to practice those free throws over and over and over again. And if you miss, you're going to probably practice more. But the point is, you have to know if you missed. Well, the way that we teach our kids right now, without digital tools, they don't know when they missed. They do their work. They turn it in. They might get feedback in a day or two or three. But before they actually get feedback on many of their assignments, we've taken them on to the next chapter. And so I really want us to think about that analogy as we think about the tools that we should be using when we teach our children and give them the opportunity for immediate feedback. So immediate feedback, improve the ability to personalize the learning experience and give students the potential for individual progress. Allow them to advance and allow them to take more time. We also want to really improve student engagement and the motivation around learning. Learning should be fun. Kids should want to do school, come to school, learn. So think about the engagement and the motivation. The ability, when we think about on the educator side, we want to develop tools that work for the educator. In the United States, we're losing educators. We have a teacher shortage in many of our states, if not all of our states. So why is that? And what can we do to reinvent the job itself so that the educator loves the work that they signed up to do, and why they became a teacher becomes re-energized and apparent to them? So we want to give them tools that make their role easier and give them the opportunity to spend as much time doing what they do best, which is working with students, as opposed to paperwork and minutia. We want them to have the ability to use data analytics in order to, again, have the tools work for them and help make decisions about their students' learning. And then student and parent adoption of learning in general. You know, we live in a different world now. Our kids today are practically born with those devices in their hands. This is the generation that will never know life without a cell phone and a computer. I received a voice memo from my six-year-old grandson the other day that he made on his dad's phone when his dad and his baby sister were napping and his mom had gone to work. The internet was down in the house and he was just incredibly frustrated and talking into the phone about the fact that this was crazy. The internet was down and he couldn't do anything and he couldn't do his schoolwork. Six years old. So drivers to blended learning, why are we doing this? So a little bit about what we are doing at ASU Prep Digital. We have four pillars of which we work with schools and students on. First and foremost, we have our curriculum challenges, and we develop curriculum. And as we think about developing curriculum, I'm going to talk a little bit more about that later. We have a very focused point of view about how curriculum that is developed today should be developed to engage the learner, to engage the teacher, to provide a facilitated, highly personalized environment for our students, parents, and teachers. But curriculum challenges. How do we develop the right structure to support the individual student? What does that look like, especially when we have classes of students with 20, 30, sometimes 40 individuals in that room with one teacher? How can a teacher meet the needs of 40 students in a classroom at a time without technology and digital tools? Simply, he or she can't. How can students receive accredited U.S. high school diplomas from other countries? Students that either want to come to the United States to go to the university or want to broaden their learning for other places they may want to go in the world and add that to their transcript, we can do that. We can provide that opportunity to students all around the world. And what are the best classes for students to think about when they want to get on a pathway to college? How do we map that out for them so that we can help create the journey as opposed to them being on a scavenger hunt to figure it out themselves? And then how about content? There's so much content out there. There's a lot of free content out there. There's a lot of teacher-created content out there. And then there's a lot of tested, tried, and true content out there. So how do we find the most updated content that has been tested with students and verified and validated? How do we engage those students to learn that content? What does that look like? And can we find adaptive learning tools where the actual tools learn the learner and smarter with every student that actually participates in that course, in that application? We can do that. So with teaching, again, we talk about engagement. 30, 40 kids in a class, one teacher. How do you keep those kids engaged? Digital tools. When we also think about just learning in general, where can I find a learning experience that's tailored just to me the learner, so that I'm not having to keep up with the student next to me or wait for the student behind me? And if I have another interest, that I have some type of a learning experience where I can learn through my interest and not through the interest of just whatever happens to be in the global textbook. So we are faced with so many challenges. The transition to online learning can also be a challenge, and that is in its own category, which we have all experienced lately. And changes are usually driven by challenges. So if we think about what we've been thrust into for the last 3 months, would we ever have thought the entire world all at one time would be trying to do distance learning? Heavens no. We've been trying to get people to experience distance learning and try it out for 25 years. But all of a sudden, in 3 months' time, the entire world is trying to figure it out together. So as a team, we've really learned to work with the different aspects of the challenges to develop an agile, multi-dimensional experience and create partnerships that will work for both the partner and for ASU Prep Digital to create an amazing ecosystem for our students together. We also created different structures and different models. So no two models that when we work with a collaborative partner, typically no two of those experiences look the same. It depends on the needs of the partner and the students that we're serving in that particular relationship. So I want to talk a little bit about the teaching model. So I've just spent time talking about engagement, personalization, different types of tools that attract the learner to want to learn and give them that personalized experience. So how do we do it? First of all, we do use what we consider to be very good digital tools that work for us as opposed to the other way around, and that's key. They're tried and they're true and they're tested. But we also have a very different teaching model, and this infographic that you see here shows you the shift in our classrooms that are happening in our partner schools. You see the student at the center, and then you see that student surrounded by support. We have an ecosystem of the parent, a student success coach, a learning success coach, and the teacher all working together on behalf of that student. And I'll talk about the professor in a moment. But if you think about this, the parent has to be part of our stool. We have a three-legged stool, and that parent has to be part of that stool to support the student. They need to be engaged. Interestingly enough, the last 3 months, parents have probably been more engaged in their child's learning and education than in the last 100 years. Kids weren't going to school to learn. They were learning in their home with their parents, with their learning tools. And lo and behold, many parents' eyes were opened as to their child's learning tendencies, their capabilities, their ability to focus, their engagement, their love or lack of love of learning. Parents learned a lot in the last 3 months. So the teacher, our teachers have the focus on the academics for that student. So they're doing the direct one-on-one instruction. They're giving the academic feedback. They're assigning the assignments, and they're doing the grading for the students. And then that teacher, and that's now the student, is supported by what we call a learning success coach. And a learning success coach is exactly what the name implies. It is someone who works directly with the students to help them deal with college and career planning, goal setting, learning how to manage their time, progress monitoring, and parent communication. They're that single focus for parent communication. So when the child disappears, which kids have a tendency to do sometimes in distance learning, when the child sometimes disappears, then the learning success coach is there to go find them. In our classroom models, where we are doing blended learning in our classrooms, which is most of what we do with our collaborative partners if we are all in school together, that learning success coach, again, works directly with the teacher and with the learning facilitator on campus to make sure that we don't lose track of any student. We're using the data to analyze exactly where that student is and what they need every moment to continue to advance. So it's a really fabulous model in terms of how we wrap support around our students. So the professor. One of the things that ASU Prep Digital is most known for is the fact that it is embedded in the university, and that our president, President Michael Crow, is committed to students. As I said before, whether they are 4 or they are 94, they have a place to come into our institution to learn whatever it is that they desire to learn. The also very smart man wanted to create an environment where students could move on and advance when they were ready. We, somebody, I don't know who we is, but we designed these boxes called elementary school or primary school, middle school, high school or secondary school. And then we decided that one of them was going to be 5 or 6 grades from this age to this age. And then another one would be 3 years, you know, from about 12 to 11 or 12 to 14. And then we'd finish up with 4 years of high school. And most of our students at the end of high school would be 18 or 19 years old. And then they would go off to another box called college, which was, again, 4 years. So what we've done, we've removed all those barriers of age and grade level. And we have created pathways for students at any grade and at any age level when they are ready to begin college in high school. So if a student is 13, and we have one, 14, 15, 16, and they are ready to advance their learning, they have a pathway into the majors at ASU. They actually start and have the opportunity to begin taking bona fide, authentic ASU classes online. Yep, they might be in a class with someone who's 30 years old, and that's where that learning success coach and that parent comes into play. We work very closely with the student and the school to navigate post-secondary education for this child. That's included in our program, and some of our students are able to graduate high school with 50-plus ASU college credits at a significantly reduced price. And that's because our president wants to reduce time and cost to degree so that everybody, every learner has the opportunity to go to college. You'll also see over here on the left, we do have an ELL, or English Language Learner, focus with our teachers, and they have been trained to work with students of all different diversities, and our content itself is equipped with resources to support learning, with study guides, vocabulary, oral assessments, mini video lessons, all to support the learner regardless of their language or their struggles with English. So this is just a screenshot of one of our flagship courses, and my colleague Lisa Edgar is going to put a link into the chat box so that you can take a little course tour of BioBeyond. When I call it a flagship course, that is because this type of quality is the quality that we are aiming for in all the new development of courses that we are in the midst of working on and through. This particular course starts with a question, and the question is, are we alone in the universe? And each of the modules capitalizes on a student's curiosity. And so as the students start to work on these different modules, this one happens to be into the cell, and it actually takes them into the cell with a virtual reality type experience. The students all have a different experience depending on the pathway that they choose. And again, this course gets smarter with every new student that we serve, and more pathways are developed. Our goal is to engage, to spark curiosity, and we do think that this is a most beautiful course as well. We call it our Pixar course, but this is our flagship, this is what we're aiming towards, and this is what we believe students have a right to experience in their digital experience, in their digital platform. So, what can we do for you or for our partners? These are our implementation models that you see here in front of you. Training and professional development. We have a full-time teaching staff, and so we can do all the full-time teaching if that is what a collaborative partner would like. We are most focused on upskilling or enabling our collaborative partners to actually do the teaching themselves. but we can mentor their teachers, we can co-teach, and as I said, we can actually do the teaching from a distance with a highly qualified teacher. We have a new teacher orientation. We do adaptive learning training for our teachers. We have lead teachers and mentor teachers that we train and give ongoing support. We have professional learning communities that support our staff. And in that process, we'll do book talks, we'll do different types of online training, different types of discussion groups. But again, that's all how we can train a full-time teaching staff. We also have an adjunct teaching staff, and we can train our collaborative partners' adjunct teaching staff. Again, you'll see most of the same types of trainings that we do for that model as well, and we just tailor it to a teacher that is part-time. And then the school partnership support. We have a blended learning specialist that comes into the schools either virtually or in person, depending on the situation, and trains the teachers at that school site on blended learning and the implementation around blended learning. That blended learning specialist also specializes in adaptive learning training. So the course that I just spoke about, BioBeyond, the training that goes with that course would be the training that we would provide for our teachers to really understand how to use those adaptive learning tools. So again, that they work for the teacher. And the data analytics, et cetera, are there for them, and we teach them how to use that. All the technical training, as well as learning or lab facilitator training for the person who is on site supporting the students while we are at a distance. We also work with our teachers' college at ASU to provide training as well as opportunities for credentials and badges and degrees, if that is something that they would want. Then special workshops and training, these are customized, and we have an opportunity to customize a workshop specifically for our collaborative partners. Oftentimes, we have done the same type of workshops with our own teachers, and so almost all of the time, anything that we do with our collaborative partners, we've done in-house first with our own teachers, our own students, and our own parents. But again, blended learning, other webinars and workshops. We're now doing parent workshops, teaching parents how to ready their students in a remote learning environment, and teaching students how to ready themselves to learn online, because we didn't get to do that when everybody just got sent home. And we forget teaching and learning in an online or a blended environment is different. Most of our teachers have not been trained to teach that way, and most of our learners have not been trained, and I do mean trained, to learn that way. So collectively, our team at ASU Prep Digital has over 30 years of experience in digital education. We know that the future is and can be very uncertain. We are all living in that time right now. For us, we believe that the future of education should be personalized, it should be adaptive, it should be flexible, and it should not matter whether the student is at home or the student is in a building we call school or out in our environment, in our world, traveling the world, learning as they go. Technology should be leveraged to empower education to serve our students in a very personalized way so that we can actually meet every learner's individual needs. So learning should not be confined to time. It should not be confined to place. We've certainly learned. And we also should not define it or confine it by demographics. It should happen anywhere, anywhere. So one of the things that I've always liked to say is that school, which if you look it up in the dictionary, the Webster's Dictionary, will tell you that it is a noun. It's a place. Well, I believe that school should be a verb. It should be something that we are actively doing regardless of where we are, regardless of where we are sitting. and regardless of where we're going to be tomorrow. Learning should take place everywhere. So who is this little girl that you see on the screen now? That might be your child. That might be your grandchild. That might be your friend, your best friend's child. We all play a very important role in her journey to a successful and a happy life. It's our job, it's our responsibility, and it's our commitment to prep these students for college, prep them for careers, and prep them for life. I thank you for your time. I appreciate, again, being invited to speak with you tonight, and I look forward to working with you. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you so much, Julie. That's really, really insightful, and I think we learned a lot here. And, you know, we have about 5,000 teachers now, you know, being the audience. So I think all of them giving you a digital applause now.
So thank you.
This is very nice. So do you still have time for a question and answer?
I do.
Okay, great. Let me talk to the audience. Bapak Ibu sekalian, sekarang Anda bisa bertanya. Kalau yang mau menggunakan bahasa Inggris bisa langsung raise hand. Nanti saya akan unmute. Oke, saya mulai dengan lalu Gufran Hadi, silakan, Pak. Ya, silakan. Belum bisa ya. Oke.
Questions in the chat box, Indra. Do you wanna just maybe?
Yeah, I will start with the one who raises his hand first. I will try Pariski Pradana.
Okay, thank you. Is it already unmuted?
Yes.
Okay. I would like to appreciate what Julie has presented to us about how the visual perpetual learning is running. But the thing is, what we lose. Okay,
Pak Rizky, go ahead.
Okay, the thing that sometimes we forget about the emotional connection between teachers and students. That is really, really like usually missing from the virtual learning. Because sometimes we don't get emotional warmth, we don't get the interaction, the affections while doing the virtual. How would you what do you think about it? What do you think about it? Is there a solution about how to implement or how to achieve the same affection that is from the offline classroom with the virtual classroom? I think that's all. Is it clear enough?
Okay, Julie, do you understand what the question is?
I do.
Okay.
I do.
Go ahead.
So it is a great question. It is one that is frequently asked, and I would say that at ASU Prep Digital, we very much focus on high tech and high touch. And our goal is that our teachers know our students better than they have ever known a student in a classroom. The teacher and the students have a unique opportunity to connect one-on-one, and then the students have a unique opportunity to connect in small groups without a great deal of peer pressure when the teacher facilitates online discussions and activities, etc. But you have to design online activities, to your point, that bring students together to have these social emotional times together outside of just the learning. So we have an assortment of clubs, whether that be student council or a chess club or a math club. We actually had a group of our students this year plan a prom, and they were going to actually come together from all over the country for the prom before graduation. The students came up with that. We also plan different kinds of activities for kids who live in the same region, for them to come together in, you know, like on a weekend for a field trip, so to speak. And we actually plan those for kids in regions in different places throughout the country. We did it for a virtual school. We plan to do it as we scale here so that kids can get to know other kids that are actually in their learning environment. I think the other thing that is really incredibly important is that's why I emphasize so much that the parent has to be part of that three-legged stool. That child has to have other interaction. They have to have other social engagements outside of the learning. And what we've learned over the last 25 years with parents who homeschool their students, they typically spend about 3 to 4 hours a day schooling, and then those children are involved in other activities for the remainder of the day where they're actually socializing with other students, they're playing, they're doing music lessons or sports activities, etc. And so you have to be very deliberate about how to create the human connections. But I will tell you that most of our students will tell you that they know their teacher at ASU Prep Digital better than they have known any teacher they've ever had in their traditional school.
Thank you, Julie. Now, second question from Bu Yanti Rosdiana Beruntu. Can go ahead and ask. Yanti. Hello. Okay. If not, then let's next from Budermawati. Would you like to ask a question?
Hello. Thank you, Bapak. Good morning, Miss Julie. Julie.
Morning.
I want to ask you. And frankly speaking, I'm satisfied to hear your explanation. And you have good experience in virtual learning. We in Indonesia, we have virtual learning just by an accident, because of the COVID-19. So I would like to ask you, how should we prepare to make the virtual learning to be successful for the teachers, for the students? Since I heard that you explained that from the curriculum, we plan the curriculum, and then we also design the model, we also train the teachers. Can you give us some tips to be successful in teaching learning from many factors like curriculum and the others, from the top, the most important things to the least? Thank you.
Sure. So I think we all agree that how everyone was thrust into virtual learning 3 months ago is not ideal, and nor would we like to replicate that. Teachers need to have the opportunity to be trained and to learn how to teach differently. And so, as you described, first and foremost, we have to get our teachers ready, and we have to get them mentally ready as well as physically ready for a new way of teaching and learning. In an online environment, a teacher's role really changes. It changes to much more of, you know, the cliche of a guide on the side or a facilitator of learning. And we spend a lot of time teaching kids how to learn as opposed to what to learn. And so we become much less of a giver of information, which is what teachers have always been, is we kind of take everything in our brain and dump it into the student's brain and try to make them smarter. And we know in today's world that none of us are smarter than this little device here. And so most importantly is getting teachers to understand that their role has changed in this type of environment and that they need to teach students how to learn differently. With that said, secondly, and equally as important, is having a solid curriculum that again works for the teacher and the teachers can feel confidence in using with their students. One of the things that happened 3 months ago when everybody just went home is teachers were like overnight given tools that they potentially had never used, had never had training or experience with, and had to go home and start creating content on their own. And teachers were not trained to be textbook writers or publishers or software developers. They were trained to teach content, most often other content that someone else had developed and had vetted and had put in their hands as a solid curriculum tool. So finding a curriculum that you are comfortable with and that will work for the teacher so that the teacher isn't spending mountains of time creating online lessons, which is very, very difficult as they go into this type of an experience. The third thing I would say is patience. Really important to take some baby steps. We didn't get to do that 3 months ago either because everybody was sent home and tried to do everything at once to replicate the classroom. I would advise that you don't try to replicate the traditional classroom in a fully at a distance model or in a blended model. You want to reinvent. You want to use the tools to work differently for teaching and for learning. You have an opportunity to literally personalize an education experience for each individual student by using the digital tools with efficacy. And so don't think about replicating, think about reinventing, recreating, again with that student at the center of your decisions. And then finally, making sure that the parents really understand what this is all about and how they can be supportive and helpful. It's not going to be perfect right out of the gate. And I think it's important for parents to know that and for students to know that and for you to give your parents and your students the license and the opportunity to share back what's going well and what isn't going well so that you can adjust and improve your program along the way. And so those are the tips that I think are most important. The last thing I'll say is that what we're doing right now is pretty interactive because now we're having questions and answers. But I just spent 30 minutes talking at you, and I would be willing to guess that many of you might have been doing some email while you were listening to me, maybe talking to a colleague or a child occasionally if you're in your home. Easy to get distracted. So be careful how you use Zoom. Taking Zoom and trying to replicate your classes by doing lecture over Zoom is like, it's incredibly tiresome for the teacher and the student, and it will not be successful. This tool should be used for delivering information, for having dialogue, but not overused. It's a fabulous tool for what we're doing and what we're trying to do, but don't overuse it.
Thanks, Julie. Let me put the chat box here. There is an interesting question asking you whether you have experience in delivering blended learning or online learning to vocational schools, vocational studies, trade schools. How would that be possible?
It is possible for us to deliver instruction and blended learning to any school. We don't, our focus has not been on delivering those specific CTE courses. We have some, but most of our courses are college prep. And so we can deliver the core courses into those schools in a blended learning or at a distance, either one, very effectively.
Okay, thank you. Another interesting question. How about assessment in distance or remote learning? How do you assess students effectively, you know, using blended learning, online learning, distance learning like this?
That's another really good question, because I think all of us worry about and should be mindful about academic integrity, whether you're in a traditional classroom or you are in an online environment. And so when we think about assessments in an online environment, we work to embed those assessments into the content. And so oftentimes students aren't even aware they're being assessed and that data is being collected on the back end through the analytics, so that we can see what that learner is knows and is doing well, and then the course actually will adapt to go back and scaffold the learning for that student in the areas that they are having difficulty. The courses that are not that sophisticated yet, we have many different ways that we assess students. Obviously, through formative assessment that is embedded in the course, through just assessment assignments like we would do in a traditional classroom. But probably the killer app for us is what we call a discussion-based assessment. And a discussion-based assessment is a one-on-one conversation between the student and the teacher, where the teacher takes all the information that they've gathered about the student. They look at what that student has done in terms of the lessons that they have completed and where their gaps in learning are. And they actually create an individualized oral conversation with the student to kind of dive into the areas where the student should know the material or may be weak in that particular area. And then from that, the teacher can then customize next steps or a path for that student moving forward. And the other thing that some schools actually have assessments where they use the video capability of something like ProctorU, which I'm assuming you've probably heard of, where the student actually takes an assessment in a videoed environment from their distant location, where the teacher is actually able to observe. Andrew, you're on mute.
Thank you. I'm going to give the chance to Pak Asep Denny from Pakuan University. Please go ahead, Pak.
Okay, thank you, Pak Indra. Good morning, Julie. Nice to meet you.
You too.
Okay. I would like to ask some questions. I am lecturers in the University of Pakuan, private university. The location is as southern part area from Jakarta, about 1 hour. Julie, this is my concern, how to implement the online learning. This is especially in COVID situations, my university forced all the students to use online learning. So this is new normal for us, how we push the students to familiar with online coursings, because as you know, almost in Indonesia, students not too familiar with online learning because the culture I saw in my university, especially the students are not too familiar with this online learning, but because of these situations, they must study about this. The problem is in our culture, for my students especially. So I need your suggestion and your explanation how to make this core to be continued, not only this current situation, but in the future. Because we have to focus on the high tech in the future, and I really want to implement in my faculty. I am just elected as the dean for the period of 2020 until 2025. So I would like to implement this kind of study, not only this current situation, but also in the future. And the second one, how I can make the collaboration with you in the future. That's all. Thank you.
So first of all, I would invite you, when the time is right and when we can travel, I would invite you to come to Arizona State University for a visit. And very much would like you to meet the team that works at the university level that has created ASU Online and has been very successful over the last, I think, probably 8 years, 8 to 10 years of that implementation. As we are moving forward, and how our president and our leadership at the university is thinking about this, is that we will never go back to where we were in terms of, you know, what we called normal before. And so, you know, our new normal, as you said, will give students different choices in how they learn, and give our professors, our staff, our teachers different choices in how they teach. And so we actually at ASU are implementing 5 models for August, for the fall. And, you know, obviously one of the models is that students will be invited back to campus, and we will obviously are figuring out what that looks like in terms of social distancing, et cetera, as all of us are. But then also asynchronous learning, where most of the learning is online. Students will have that choice, and teachers will have that choice, professors have that choice to teach. That's ASU Online primarily. Then we also have another program that we're calling ASU Sync. and what ASU Sync is really utilizing tools like Zoom and WebEx to have live interaction and live classrooms, so to speak, in a virtual environment. So more of a lecture format like we're having right now. And then another model is our what we call OpenScale, and that is, it's an online environment, but there's more adaptive tools, there's more interaction. But I think the point that I'm trying to make is that we're giving our students and our faculty choices. So as everybody's getting kind of started down this pathway, you know, we went from having a group of people that were in ASU Online, and they were the ones that created the courses and taught the courses online, and then everybody else, you know, obviously went to a classroom and delivered instruction. And so with everybody now having to move to online, as you're experiencing, we're trying to think about, okay, as we bring people back, whether it's the students or the faculty, how do we continue the learning around technology-enabled instruction and digital tools and maximizing any learning experience with the technology? So a lot of training, a lot of encouragement, a lot of choice, that, you know, so we're not forcing our students and we're not forcing our faculty, but we're giving them options, tools, and training.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
And we would love to collaborate with you. I know that our leadership at the university would be most interested in connecting with you this way.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Julie.
Just let me know.
Okay. Thank you, Paitra.
You're welcome, Parasen. Julie, there's a lot of questions here for you, but unfortunately, our time is up. So I think I will get, you know, some of the questions through email.
Okay.
And then
we'll be happy to respond in email.
Or that your team, you know, to answer. Great. Then again,
perfect.
Thank you very much for your time here, your experience. It's really inspire us to, you know, to do this type of learning in the right way. So again, it's an honor to have you here, and you can leave the room now if you may. We have another one more presenter to present.
All right, thank you very much, and the honor was mine. Thank you for having me.
Thank you. Bye bye. Bapak-Ibu sekalian, berikutnya adalah dari Epson, Pak Zanipar Syadari akan share dengan kita mengenai program
The recording has stopped.
Termasuk juga door prize yang menarik dari beliau. Silakan Pak Zanipar.
Oke. Terima kasih Pak Indra. Saya boleh langsung share screen ya, Pak? Oke, selamat pagi. Pak Indra, sebelumnya boleh saya cek suara saya kedengaran dan materi saya terlihat di layar? Pak Indra masih
dengar dengan baik dan sudah kelihatan, Pak.
Oke. Okay. Maaf. Oke. Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Salam sejahtera untuk kita semua. Om Swastiastu, Namo Buddhaya, salam kebajikan. Pertama-tama saya ingin mengucapkan terima kasih kepada Pak Indra yang sekaligus sebagai moderator pada acara ini. Kemudian juga tak lupa mengucapkan terima kasih kepada pihak Kemendikbud, yaitu tadi ada Pak Azan ya, sudah memberikan sambutan. So I'd like to say hi also to Julian, who already gave some inspiring material during the morning. So I think I'll start my presentation. Please introduce, I am Jennifer from Epson Indonesia, and I'm taking care of product marketing in Epson. So this morning I'd like to share the innovative teaching with digital technology in the new normal. Okay, assuming the new normal, actually in Indonesia, right, we are still in discussing whether the school is going to be, whether the student is going to be back to the schools within next month. The Ministry of Education also hasn't confirmed, but my presentation will see from the general point of view or perspective whether the student will be back or by when this technology innovation will be able to be implemented. Okay. So before I go to the next material, let me introduce our company. As I mentioned, I was from Epson. So Epson is a part of OSA subsidiary company from Seiko Epson Corporation. So if some of you maybe notice about Seiko Watts, there is one of our product, because our headquarter is Seiko Epson Corporation, then the company name in Indonesia is PT Epson Indonesia. Our office location in Seoul, Jakarta, exactly in CBIS 9 building. So we are 20 years now in Indonesia. We have developed many solution and also many product, which is not only for international consumption, but also dedicated for Indonesia market. So for Epson itself, we have a innovation, which is Epson 25 innovations. We have four area of innovation, which is in-depth innovation, robotic innovation, visual innovation, and wearable innovation. Why we did this innovation? Because of we have a vision to create a connected edge of people, things, and also information with an efficient, compact, and also supporting with the precision technology. So all of the product is invented to help the people's life, to help the people's doing their job, and also including to help the students or the schools also in the new normal era later. Then our first product is EP, electronic printer. The model's name is EP101. This product is the first printer that used in the Olympic during the 1964. So this product is connected with Seiko Watts, recording the timing that the athletic or the runner is consuming during the athletic games. Then after recorded by the time machine, then after that it will be printed immediately. So this is the product for the printer itself. Then our P&L is expecting this product to have a lot of or multiply with the many descendants and also many successful product. That's why up to now we already have 100 or even thousands product that we market to all over the world. Let's see the product itself. We are leading in the printer market, which is we have market share number one for Indonesia and worldwide. And also projectors, we are also number one in the product projector market, both in Indonesia and also in the world. Then we also scanner, number one in Indonesia. Then we have a signage printer, number one in Indonesia and in the world. Then after that, we also have a SCARA robot. Our robot now is utilized for manufacturing. So to serve the customer in Indonesia, we have a complete set of after sales coverage, which is from Medan to Papua. Actually, I haven't put Papua here, but we also have in Sorong. And we have been to Nabire before. I noticed that one of the attendants, one of the audience this morning also came from Nabire. So what is the education in the new normal? I believe if all of you have listened to the Julie's presentation this morning, and some of the material also actually covered by her, which is in the education environment, we are expecting the education system will be built or developed into a student-oriented education system. The objective or the aims is to have a good student's experience. What is the good student experience? It means the student have a very good process when they doing learning in the schools or at home, both in the normal and also in the new normal conditions. So when we are talking about student experience, that will be supported by three parts. First is the culture itself, the school's cultures and also the people cultures. The second will be the physical infrastructures. Physical infrastructure is the schools itself, the classroom and also the facilities. And then the technology. The last one is the technology. So if the schools or the education implemented with a good technology, with a good physical infrastructures, in a good social culture, then we will have a good student experience during having the education. So if you notice that in the education environment, there are schools, there are teachers, there are social cultures, there are parents, and there are Ministry of Education as the education regulator in Indonesia. So all of them that involved in this education has to support one another to create a new or a good education environment to the student. So when coming to the new normal, there are several things that need to consider, not only by the government but also by the school itself. And if you notice or if you can see in my screen, first is the physical space. So if the student later on back to the schools, there may be some shifting classroom. Shifting classroom means some of the student will go, let's say on Monday, and some of the student will go to the schools on Tuesday. Then continue. Then there probably a multi-classroom teaching. The teacher has to divide one class to become two class. So probably some schools will occupy a library, a multimedia room, or laboratorium to become a new classroom. So let's say in one classroom there are 25 or let's say 30 students, then they will be divided into two groups, then 15 for the first class, then 15 for the second class. Then the teacher has to teach them all together in a different classroom or in a different place. Or the next is a mixed classroom. Mixed classroom means currently we are doing or we are adopting the online learning or distance learning. So some of the students go to the schools, let's say on the first week of the month, 15 students go to the schools, then 15 remain at home. So the teacher, when teaching, he has to do two jobs, teaching physically in the classroom, but also have to teach the students through virtually, through application. Yeah, that is for the physical space. The second, of course, the student motivation. We already keep the students at home within 2 or 3 months. And I believe they will face a new or a different kind of learning environment compared to the normal classroom before. So when they go back to the schools, they will have a new habit. And the schools or the teachers need to tell them what is the best or the better new habit in the schools. Let's say they cannot play together like more than 10 students in the same place, then they need to take care of their interactions. They cannot go to the other classroom, they have to remain inside the classroom, or they have to, you know, they cannot go together to the canteen or to the washroom. Then there should be a new learning method, so to keep the student motivated with the new situation. And the third is the most important thing is there has to be a collaboration between the school's leaders or the teachers with the parents. So when the student go back to the school, it's not like what we have before. Normally when the parents send their kids to the school, then everything taken care by the teachers. Then the parents go to work, back to home, working at home, or they go to the office. Then the student will back at the afternoon to the home, then after that return to the family. But in the new normal, the parents also have to take care of the kids even during in the schools. So both the teachers, the schools leaders, and also the parents have to support one another. Then the education, as Julius mentioned, education is a verb. Education is not a noun, it's not a place. Education has to be done by both sides, schools leaders, parents, and also teachers, both at schools and also at home. So it is very important to have a good collaboration between those two parties. So what is the best technology for the new normal? Of course, to keep the student motivated, we can create, the schools or the teacher can create some interactive and attractive learning. But first of all, we need to ensure, because the classroom later on will be formed in a different way, then we need to projection is good enough to cover all to the students. You know, if you have some projection image too small, then some student at the backside will not see it as clear, then they will start to not concentrating or concentrate on another things, not to the teaching material. So we need to define what is the best display in the classroom. So this is the rule of thumb of defining that there is an analytical viewing, which is the student can see the graphic and the text very good. Then there is a basic viewing. Basic viewing, the student can see only the presentations. When they have to see the text, it is not really in a good vision for them. Then the last one is the passive viewing. Passive viewing, most probably the student that have to sit in the very rear seat. So let's say they will be like 8 meters from the projection image. Then those students that sit in behind, they will only acting as a passive viewing. They can only see movie and video good, but they cannot see the presentation or the text or the graphic good. So if we compare, let's say if one classroom has 65-inch television or 65-inch projection image with 30 students in the classroom, then the right side, a classroom that 100-inch, which is 2 meters wide, by using ultrasonic interactive projectors. So if you notice the green one, which is marked with 4 times, it means the area is 4 times distance to 4 times of image height distance to the screen. So those students locating or sitting in the green or light green will have a good vision to the presentation. But the students located in the yellow one, they have less vision, which is now they are in a passive viewing. They can see only video and image good. Text they cannot see properly. And some presentation also they cannot see properly. Then the red area, the students that located in the red area will not see anything. It is only visible, but they cannot read. So it's not good for the student itself. So if this classroom we change the display to become 100-inch display or coming from the projector, you can see most of the student will be located in the green and light green area, which is means they can be a active viewing and also they can be in a good vision. So if you go back to the presentation before, one page before, those who are located in a green and light green will have analytical viewing and will have a basic viewing, which is good for the student itself. Okay, then how the teachers can do multi-classroom teaching? Let's say when the student go back to the schools, they have to divide it into 2 classrooms. So 15 in classroom A and 15 in classroom B. Then if the students, teachers or schools utilizing the interactive projectors, one of our products, the interactive projector can be installed in a different classroom. Then we can connect the projector to the network that already exists in the schools. Then the teacher can teach from one classroom and the other classroom will see whatever he write on the projector in the classroom B. So now the teacher in classroom A, he write lesson 1, then the student in class B will see also lesson 1 on their classroom or on their screen. And the teacher doesn't need to do 2 times. Let's say he write on the classroom 1 and then after that he move to the classroom B and also write the same thing. Doesn't require to do so. So the teachers can be in a classroom 1 or in a classroom 2. So it's a good teaching method that we, the teacher later they can adopt in the schools. So what kind of product will be used? It is the ultrasonic interactive projector. The image is big, 2 meters or can be 2.6 meters wide. Then in a short distance, so if you can see in the image at the left side, there will be no glare, there will be no shadow on the screen. And it is interactive. The teachers can write anything with his finger or with his pen. So it doesn't require a very special board. It can be a school's wall. It can be a school's board. Whatever the school already have in the classroom, then the teacher can use for the projector interactive. And the benefit for the teachers is they can do presenting by wireless and Miracast. so the teachers can go around the classroom without have to carry some cable. Then the projector itself has a digital whiteboard. Okay, so anything that the teacher write, he doesn't need to erase if he already from the projection, because although the projection you can see only one page, but actually it can be up to 20 pages. So if you finish from the first page, you can move to the second page up to the 20 page without have to erase anything. Then immediately after the teacher finish teaching, all the material can be directly emailed to the students, to the parents, or to the school's leaders, and also can direct computer or any PC. Then after that, you can distribute to the student, and the student can bring the teaching material up to the home, to the house. So let me show you one of the video. So to enable you listen, can listen to the audio, I will change. Okay.
Hi there. I'm Cody, and I want to take a couple of minutes to better acquaint you with the Epson Brightlink 1480 series interactive laser display, the ultimate interactive display for modern classrooms. Brightlink 1480 series laser displays provide a large 16x9 HD display up to 100 inches, ensuring that students can easily see the content and remain engaged in class. The Brightlink 1485 Fi can also support a massive 16x6 display up to 120 inches. At over 9 feet wide, this is nearly two times the display area of a 75-inch flat panel. And because Brightlink displays can be used on a typical whiteboard, you don't lose valuable classroom space when the display is not in use. See, the whiteboard is still available when I shut off the Brightlink. Try doing that with a flat panel. While the interactive functionality of both Brightlink displays are largely the same, today we'll be demonstrating on the ultra-wide Brightlink 1485 Fi. And let me just turn it on. Now I'm going to grab my pen, or I can use my finger. So what you're seeing here is a projection on a whiteboard. With this solution, you can project on your walls, or tables, or basically any flat surface. So let's get started. The home screen has a touch-enabled interface that allows you to select whatever it is that you want to do. There is PC-free digital whiteboarding, or you can select any connected source to display, such as a PC, document camera, or video player. Whatever you choose to display, you have the ability to annotate over it. So let's begin. On whiteboard mode, let's start writing something like spelling words using the available interactive pens or my finger. As you can see, my notes are being projected.
So if you can see the teacher can erase whatever he writes, then he can erase.
When I make a typo,
his hand.
No problem, because I can easily erase it with my hand. And when I run out of space, all I have to do is click here to make a new page, and everything on the previous whiteboard will be saved. If I want, I can insert a shape like this, or I can even upload my own content from my USB drive. Attach it directly here, and hey, there it is. Then I can move it, resize it, or if I want to make an annotation, I can do that too. Okay, so now what if I want to use my computer instead of using the PC-free whiteboard? Not a problem. I can connect my PC via HDMI or VGA and see my screen up on the whiteboard. Now that might not seem exciting, but when I connect a USB cable as well and open something like PowerPoint, I can start interacting with my PC. Essentially, the board becomes a 120-inch monitor, and the pen, or my finger, becomes the mouse. It's like having a giant tablet. Think of it this way. Anything that runs on my computer, I can now run up here on the board. It's really that simple. This is all about collaboration. Another way you can use the Brightlink is as a video conferencing display. All I have to do is connect my video conference application like Zoom or Skype, and enjoy the super wide display.
Hi, Cody.
Hi, Meg. The great thing is you don't need a flat panel for your video conference. Just one Brightlink 1480 series laser display, and you're good to go. I can also use split screen to display my PC content on one side and my whiteboard on the other, and get everyone collaborating at the same time. Bye, Meg.
Hi, Cody.
Similarly, I can go to the home screen and choose split screen to display content on up to four connected devices simultaneously. PCs, Macs, document cameras, Blu-ray players, or even from wireless devices via Miracast connection, or using eye projection, Epson's free wireless display app. And by using Epson Eye Projection, you can connect, display, and share content simultaneously from up to 50 connected devices, getting the whole classroom involved in daily lesson plans. I can easily share my whiteboard content with other Brightlink projectors too. Simply select the home button on the bottom left of the display to access the home screen. Then press screen sharing to initiate the shared setting. I can share my whiteboard content with other network connected Brightlink 480 series projectors. When your Brightlink projectors are on the same network, it is easy to share the whiteboard space, allowing students or teachers in other classrooms to view and contribute to the whiteboard session. They'll be able to see anything on my whiteboard, and I'll be able to see anything they write. If any of the other classrooms would like to join in and add to the shared whiteboard just like I did a second ago, they can do so by using their interactive pens or finger. And there it is. When the class is over, I can email these notes, print, or send them later. And what's super neat is that I've done all of this without special software or a computer. So there you have it. Brightlink 1480 series laser display from Epson, offering many great ways to boost productivity and increase student engagement. To learn more, please visit www.
Then, let's see how the product when implemented in Indonesia.
Sangat menarik ya, kenapa? Karena pengajarnya bukan hanya mengajarkan sebuah teori one way talking gitu, tapi dia mengajak semua murid yang ada untuk terlibat. Dan terlebih lagi kami sangat dibantu dan murid-murid sangat antusias bisa langsung mencoba dan aktif melalui proyektor.
Pengamatan saya sih kan sudah ingin membuat anak-anak lebih aktif ya di dalam menerapi setiap pelajaran, apalagi ini kan perpaduan antara whiteboard dengan projector, sehingga mereka juga bisa mengekspresikan apa yang mereka dapat dalam pengalaman mereka dengan menggambar, bukan hanya mendengarkan guru, tetapi mereka bisa mengekspresikan apa yang mereka dapat.
Melakukan suka itu saat kita bisa coret-coret whiteboardnya, terus itu kayak itu menghemat waktu juga, soalnya kalau misalkan kita coret-coret mau hapus gampang, tinggal pencet select doang itu langsung mau hapus.
You or maybe some of you doing the virtual classroom. So if you interest with this product, we will give you a free license of Zoom for 1 year. So you can do virtual classroom for the whole year, 12 months. Okay.
Hey everybody, it's Jason with Epson. And we know a lot of people are working at home right now, or learning from home, or teaching from home. So we wanted to just take a few minutes and show you how you can use an Epson document camera to quickly connect to your computer and use it with a video conferencing software. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to connect the document camera itself. So it's just a USB cable. I'm going to connect it to my PC, plug it right into a USB port. Once it connects, I'm ready to go. So I'm going to start a Zoom meeting like you would normally start a Zoom meeting. So I invited my friend Veronica here, and we're going to start a meeting. So down in the lower left-hand corner of your Zoom session, you'll see a Start Video button. And right next to that, there's a up arrow. So I'm just going to click on that up arrow, and you should see the cameras that are available to you. On mine, I have the camera that's built into my PC, and then I have the document cameras. And this will work with any of our document cameras. So I'm going to start off, I'm going to connect, I'm just going to click on the document camera, and it'll take a few seconds and the document camera will connect. Once it's connected, I can start showing documents for objects on the document cameras, which you use a document camera for. But the great thing about document cameras is that you can also rotate the camera itself So now I can lecture in front of the document camera. So if you have a whiteboard or some other, like an easel, something that you want to show, you can do that and lecture in front of the camera. And one more great feature about Zoom or any of these softwares is you can actually switch back and forth, and it will cut back to me on my PC. So now you're seeing me at my PC screen here.
You can have a very comfortable,
and then I can switch back and forth to the document camera. So I'm going to rotate this back down. Let's say I'm doing a lesson. I want to talk to my students, and then I want to switch back to the document camera. Well, I've just cut quickly right back to the document camera, and then I can come back to myself. This is an easy.
Yeah, then the last one. As I mentioned, we need to keep the student motivated. So we can implement the learning gamification, which is by using the learning gamification in the system itself, we have a more mastery, more enthusiasm, more participation, and also have a good initiative. So I think that's all from my side. Thank you. Stay healthy di rumah aja. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih. Saya kembalikan ke Pak Indra.
Selamat siang, selamat pagi, Pak Zanipan.
Ya, selamat pagi, Pak Video.
Oh ya, mohon maaf, Pak Zanipan, saya mengambil alih karena Pak Indra tugas lain. Mudah-mudahan sudah dikomunikasikan ya.
Oke.
Bapak Ibu, selamat pagi untuk kita semua. Saya Fidel, tak hanya Pak Indra Karisimianji. Terima kasih untuk Pak Zanipan sudah mempresentasikan bahannya tadi. Sekarang saya beri kesempatan kepada Bapak Ibu sekalian untuk mengajukan pertanyaan-pertanyaan terkait dengan presentasi dari Pak Zanipan barusan. Silakan, ada yang di sini sudah ada yang mungkin yang angkat tangan, Ibu Dermawati. Silakan Ibu Dermawati. Ibu mohon maaf di unmute dulu mikrofonnya, dihidupkan dulu baru ya. Halo Ibu Dermawati. Mikrofonnya belum dihidupkan, Bu. Kalau tidak, silakan menuliskan pertanyaannya di live chat Zoom ini ya, Bu. Saya beri kesempatan kepada peserta yang lain untuk mengajukan pertanyaan. Mungkin ada yang mau bertanya, silakan. Langsung hidupkan mikrofonnya, lalu perkenalkan diri dan silakan ajukan pertanyaan. Mungkin sambil menunggu pertanyaan dari para peserta, Pak Zanipar, mungkin Bapak Zanipar menjelaskan sedikit tadi mengenai door prize. Mungkin kalau disebut door prize, para peserta ini bisa ada ide untuk bertanya gitu. Silakan Pak, mungkin dijelaskan dulu door prize kita hari ini kira-kira apa dan bagaimana tata caranya?
Ya, terima kasih Pak Fadil. Ya. Jadi untuk door prize, silakan mengisi feedback form yang sudah di-share di grup chat. Yaitu https://tinyurl.com/feedback-epson. Jadi silakan diisi, kemudian nanti dilengkapi feedback yang ingin disampaikan, kemudian terpresnya akan diundi dari feedback terbaik. Itu saya kirimkan lagi di room chatnya gitu ya. Kemudian mungkin tadi Pak Fidel ada beberapa yang menanyakan di dalam chat room.
Ya ya.
Ya. Jadi tadi ada pertanyaan, apakah ada program dari Epson terkait dengan pendidikan sehingga terkait dengan pengadaan di sekolah agar lebih terjangkau? Ya, tentunya kita ada dan bisa membuatkan program untuk segmen pendidikan. Nah, apabila ada Bapak Ibu yang membutuhkan, silakan memasukkan di feedback kontaknya, nanti kami akan kontak kembali. Atau tadi saya sudah sampaikan alamat email saya dan juga nomor telepon saya di alamat pertama presentasi. Jadi nanti bisa kontak kita lebih lanjut, gitu.
Oke, terima kasih Pak Zanibar. Dan untuk Bapak Ibu sekalian, begitu banyak yang menanyakan materi dari presentator hari ini ya, baik Ibu Miss Juliang dan Pak Zanibar, nanti akan dikirimkan via email, begitu ya Pak Zanibar ya, untuk materinya nanti akan dikirimkan via email para partisipan.
Ya, kita akan kirimkan menggunakan format PDF. Jadi silakan memasukkan alamat email yang baik atau yang benar di pada saat mengisi feedback Pak Fidel ya. Jadi nanti kita akan kirimkan di melalui email itu.
Oke, Pak Zanibar ya. Mungkin ada juga pertanyaan dari peserta, kalau rencana beli printer Epson Pak, ini mungkin tidak terkait dengan materi tadi ya, dan terkait juga. Apakah ada ini Pak, diskon kalau misalnya para peserta, para ya peserta webinar ini, kalau misalnya beli printer Epson, apakah ada diskon dari Epson sendiri?
Ya, tentunya untuk tahu apakah ada diskon atau tidak, nanti kita mesti cek ke bagian yang terkait. Tapi pada dasarnya, kita memiliki program-program yang dijalankan setiap bulannya. Jadi misalnya ada program tertentu untuk printer dijalankan di bulan ini, di bulan Mei atau di bulan Juni, gitu. Nah, untuk mendapatkan informasi program apa yang ada, nanti boleh mengirimkan email atau memasukkan di alamat feedback tersebut. Jadi nanti feedbacknya misalnya mohon saya dikirimkan informasi program yang tersedia untuk produk printer, proyektor atau yang lain. Kurang lebih seperti itu. Kalau angka diskonnya berapa itu saya tidak bisa share di room ini karena informasinya juga saya belum pegang saat ini, gitu.
Oke, terima kasih Pak Zanibar. Mengenai pertanyaan tadi soal program dari Epson untuk pendidikan sudah terjawab ya Bapak Ibu sekalian. karena begitu banyak yang chat ini, mungkin dari peserta yang di Zoom ini, mungkin silakan kalau mau bertanya langsung, silakan menghidupkan mikrofonnya, lalu perkenalkan diri dan berikan pertanyaannya. Sambil saya juga mengecek live chat di sini untuk beberapa pertanyaan.
Ya mungkin Pak Fidel dibantu unmute yang bertanya Pak. Atau ada Ibu Husnatul Fatimah, ada pertanyaan yang mau disampaikan?
Tidak.
Oh tidak ya? Oke. Kalau ada yang ingin bertanya silahkan dari tombol reaction kemudian raise hand supaya saya bisa unmute.
Ini pertanyaan teknis juga Pak Jennifer. Ya. Whiteboard itu berapa daya listriknya? Ini menyangkut pertimbangan untuk kapasitas listrik di sekolah-sekolah, Pak.
Ya, oke. Okay. Untuk proyektor sekelas itu kurang lebih sekitar 200 sampai 300 watt ya, Pak. Tapi jangan khawatir karena proyektor kita memiliki fitur yang bisa mengamankan proyektor dari naik turunnya listrik. Jadi pada saat naik atau turunnya listrik secara tiba-tiba itu tidak langsung merusak proyektornya. Jadi ada fitur yang kita sebut namanya direct power off. Gitu.
Oke, terima kasih Pak Jennifer. Jadi mungkin Ibu Dermawati tadi?
Iya.
Ah, ya, okay,
thank you Pak. Just now I have obstacle about the mic. The microphone is unmute. I'm sorry for that because the host maybe is not there. I would like to ask from Epson, is there a contribution from Epson to school or to Dinas Pendidikan? So frankly speaking, I am a supervisor from Dinas Pendidikan. If we supervisors are provided to use Epson to monitor, to observe, to supervise school by using Epson, it will be great. And we will also support schools to use Epson. So I just want to ask Epson if it is possible, Dinas Pendidikan, especially supervisors, are provided from Epson. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Bu Dharma. Terima kasih pertanyaannya. Thank you for your question. I think it's quite interesting. Of course, we have a program, several program support for education. First, it started from the product itself. Let's say for the education, we have provided a product with a special price. So this special price information, actually, we deliver to the schools. And somehow we send by email blast, and somehow also we send, we are doing some advertising in the social media and also in the newspaper. Then the second regarding to the supervising the schools, I think we need to discuss more what kind of program support that required. But as for our information, Bu Dharma, during 2019, we are visiting around 50 cities in Indonesia. We are meeting up to 3,000 schools. We are doing quite a lot seminars to the schools. And that's why some of our member also have traveled up to Tunabire and to Ambon. So we are very supporting to our educations. Then we are also very open
to what is the support that required, then we can have a further discussion later. Of course, if we are or if EPSON is possible to support, then we will try our best to support. But in some extent, we also have some limitations. That's why there is a lot of kind of support that we can provide to the schools. I think that is my, that will be my answer, Bu Derma.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Bu.
Yeah. Don't forget to respond.
Yeah, don't forget to key in the feedback, Bu, so we can have your contact and we can contact you later.
Okay.
Okay, thank you very much, Bu Derma.
Yeah, see you.
See you.
Terima kasih untuk Pak Zanipar dan Ibu Derma. Ini Pak Zanipar ada pertanyaan di live chat. Bagaimana caranya untuk secara update mengetahui perkembangan teknologi baru dari EPSON? Apakah secara otomatis bisa diinformasikan melalui email atau bagaimana? Lalu berikutnya juga ini pertanyaan saran dari peserta atas nama Risto Lahid. Saya kira produk ini sangat diperlukan oleh sekolah-sekolah, terutama karena pandemi ini. Saran untuk EPSON, mohon bisa mengakomodir sekolah-sekolah di seluruh wilayah yang kapasitasnya, kondisinya sangat bervariasi. Itu saja dua pertanyaan, mungkin ditanggapi dulu Pak Zanipan.
Oke, thank you Pak Fidel. First, untuk mengetahui informasi-informasi produk atau kegiatan, pertama, bisa mengunjungi website kami di www.epson.co.id, saya type di chat. Kemudian, untuk mendapatkan informasi yang lebih instan atau cepat, itu bisa mengikuti juga sosial medianya Epson yang ada di Facebook, Instagram, atau LinkedIn. Jadi, IG account-nya itu in Epson Indonesia. Jadi bisa dilihat di Facebook, di LinkedIn, atau di Instagram. Oke, tadi pertanyaan yang kedua, Pak Fidel, apa? Boleh diulang, Pak? Maaf.
Saran untuk Epson untuk mengkoordinasi seluruh wilayah, tidak hanya...
Oke. Jadi, untuk informasi, Epson itu memiliki kantor pusat di Jakarta, tapi kami memiliki kantor juga di daerah, di beberapa kota, kurang lebih sekitar 20 lokasi, Pak. 20 lokasi, 20 kota. Kemudian kami punya authorized partner yang tersebar di seluruh Indonesia. Jumlah authorized partner kami itu ada sekitar 1.200-an, Pak. Jadi bisa dicari authorized partner yang ada di daerah-daerah, atau untuk menemukan nama authorized partner yang ada di daerah tersebut bisa mengunjungi websitenya kita. Nanti lihat di daftar partnernya atau store lokatornya. Nanti bisa dilihat di situ, misalkan di Maluku kami berpartner dengan siapa di sana. Kurang lebih seperti itu, Pak Fidel.
Oke, terima kasih Pak Zanipar. Itu Bapak Ibu sekalian, silakan hubungi partner-partner Epson yang terdekat. Sebenarnya ini Pak siapa ini ya yang harus nama Aser. Ini mau bertanya langsung. Silakan Pak Aser ini.
Ya, Pak.
Iya.
Terima kasih atas kesempatan diberikan untuk pertanyaan saya untuk ke Pak Sanipar. Ini kami Pak di SMK. BBM yang kami lakukan itu kebanyakan menggunakan sistem praktek gitu. Ya, hampir di SMK itu 70% melakukan pelajaran-pelajaran produktif dibanding dengan pelajaran adaptif dan normatif. Ketika melihat kondisi laboratorium yang ada, Pak, itu terkadang ada fasilitas-fasilitas memang yang memerlukan sebenarnya peralatan-peralatan teknologi digital yang selama ini yang disediakan sekolah terkadang tidak mendukung dan tidak memadai untuk proses BBM praktek yang dilakukan. siswa, lihat bahwa jobsheet yang dibagikan itu sudah tertera spesifikasi peralatan, dan terkadang tidak mendukung dan tidak mixing dengan ketika mereka praktek. Untuk itu yang saya mau tanyakan ini, yang banyak dibahas di episode ini Pak, itu adalah terkait masalah proyektor dan printer saja. Nah, ada yang saya mau tanyakan Pak, di sekolah saya itu SMK 2 Goa, Sulawesi Selatan, itu ada jurusan multimedia. Kira-kira selain proyektor dan printer, adakah misalnya peralatan-peralatan yang Epson yang
oke, silakan.
Ya, selain proyektor dan printer, Epson memiliki produk yang sangat luas. Contohnya salah satunya, kita juga memiliki robot. Jadi robot ini juga banyak digunakan sebenarnya di factory automation atau di pabrik. Sehingga robotika juga adalah salah satu pelajaran vokasi yang ada di SMK saat ini. Kemudian, produk lainnya itu juga ada digital printing. Jadi kami juga memiliki printer yang ukurannya dari mulai A3 sampai ukuran A0. Kemudian itu juga bisa digunakan untuk printing design. Nah, akhirnya juga kami meluncurkan sebuah produk yang bisa mencetak langsung ke kaos. Jadi materialnya itu sekarang bukan hanya kertas lagi tapi kaos. Jadi apa yang didesain oleh siswa-siswi SMK tadi, setelah mereka sudah belajar desain, hasilnya itu bisa langsung dicetak di kaos. Dan kaos ini jadi bisa jadi salah satu bahan promosi untuk pekerjaan atau kegiatannya mereka di sekolah. Kemudian, kita juga bisa mencetak di ukuran kain yang cukup besar. Jadi, kami menyebutnya itu direct to fabric. Jadi, printer mencetak ke fabric. Jadi, sekarang itu banyak fashion designer yang melakukan pencetakan langsung ke atas kain di butiknya sendiri. Jadi, fashion designer ini bisa memiliki desain eksklusif gitu. Jadi karyanya itu benar-benar punya karya copyright. Nah, saya kira solusi-solusi seperti itu sangat sesuai atau sangat tepat untuk siswa-siswi di vokasi atau di SMK. Nah, saya kira masih banyak lagi Pak solusi yang bisa kami berikan untuk solusi apa untuk SMK. Nanti silakan melengkapi feedback. Nanti kita akan berkomunikasi melalui email Pak Ashar. Sekian jawaban dari saya. Mudah-mudahan berkenan atas jawabannya. Terima kasih.
Ya Pak Zeni, Pak. Oh, ada pertanyaan.
Maaf Pak, bukan Pak Asep, Pak Arman ini Pak. Pak Arman,
oh,
Arman
sorry.
Pakai merek laptop.
Oh iya, maaf.
Pada saat instalin Zoom-nya tadi, buru-buru instalin. Jadi saya pakai nama Pak Arman.
Iya, Pak Arman ya.
Big-big-nya saya sudah isi Pak. Saya okay. Sudah isi questionernya. Dan saya sudah jawab semua question yang ada di situ. Lengkap. Iya. Terima kasih. Selamat sukses
untuk Epson. Ya, terima kasih Pak Arman. Terima kasih, mohon maaf.
Pak Zanimar, ini masih ada satu pertanyaan di situ juga. Adakah penampilan dalam penggunaan forum ini nanti? Bagaimana jaringan
maaf? Ya, jadi untuk produk tadi, pertanyaan tadi saya memang jawab secara private. Ada pendampingan pastinya. Jadi Epson memberikan training kepada pengguna supaya Bapak Ibu guru di sekolah itu bisa melakukan atau menggunakan produk itu dengan baik dan tepat guna. Nah, salah satu video yang saya tampilkan tadi di salah satu sekolah swasta itu adalah salah satu bentuk pendampingan kami juga. Jadi benar-benar produk itu dihadirkan di depan kelas. Kemudian kita membantu bagaimana guru dan siswa bisa menggunakannya secara maksimal. Kurang lebih seperti itu, Pak Fidel.
Oke, ini pertanyaan satu lagi, Pak. Dari Ibu Elis Ayanti, terkait dengan virtual learning, how to be the same, since you need to be the same.
Ya, ini pertanyaannya sangat menarik ya. Jadi pertanyaannya itu, how to create the same perception between parents, student, and teacher about virtual learning. Oke, sebenarnya sebelum kita ke virtual learning, persepsi yang harus diciptakan pertama itu adalah how to create a same perception that education is not the teacher's job. It's not only the teacher's job. It's not only the school's job. It's not only the parents' job. But it's everyone's job. Itu sebabnya tadi Julie di presentasinya mengatakan bahwasanya education itu bukan kata benda. Education itu kata kerja. Which is pekerjaan itu harus dilakukan oleh semua orang gitu, yang terlibat di dalamnya. Kemudian setelah memiliki persepsi sama dengan sistem pendidikan tadi, barulah kita memiliki persepsi atau pengetahuan yang sama dengan virtual learning. Karena yang saya lihat pada saat pelaksanaan pelajaran jarak jauh atau PJJ, orang tua atau beberapa orang tua ada yang merasa seolah-olah diberikan tugas baru. Loh, yang tadinya kan guru yang ngajar, kenapa jadi orang tua yang ngajar? Seperti itu. Padahal kondisi sebelumnya itu, yang benar itu adalah murid belajar di sekolah dibantu oleh guru, murid belajar di rumah ya dibantu oleh orang tua. Jadi tergantung lokasi dan tempatnya, gitu. Nah, itu persepsi yang harus disamakan. Nah, virtual learning itu adalah tools di mana si murid akan belajar dari rumah tapi berhubungan langsung dengan mata pelajaran dan juga guru-gurunya secara virtual atau secara online. Nah, setelah selesai, maka si orang tua harus memastikan si anak-anak didik itu yang di rumah itu bisa menangkap pelajaran dengan baik. Nah, bagaimana caranya supaya ada pemahaman yang sama? Maka sekolah dipersilakan untuk berinisiatif membuat gathering-gathering orang tua melalui virtual. Beberapa sekolah di Indonesia, sebelum virtual learning itu dimulai, beberapa sekolah itu mengumpulkan orang tua atau melakukan meeting dengan orang tua. Kemudian menjelaskan bagaimana proses pembelajaran akan dilakukan selama 2-3 bulan ke depan selama masa pandemi. Nah, dengan pemahaman yang sama, maka orang tua akan menempati posisinya sebagai supporting system juga untuk sistem pendidikan kita. Kurang lebih seperti itu, Pak Fidel.
Tanggapannya, memang begitu banyak pertanyaan, lebih ke teknis saya pikir dan juga menambah sekalian. Yang lebih penting, Bapak Ibu sekalian, silakan menghubungi secara langsung, secara pribadi ke Edison ini. Dari Edison baru, juga untuk mengetahui tim beberapa pemimpin baru dari Edison. Dan juga
ya, terima kasih Pak Fidel. Terima kasih semuanya buat Bapak Ibu yang sudah hadir di acara ini dan juga sudah mengajukan pertanyaan dari tadi dan juga sudah memberikan feedback.
Oke. Baik, Bapak Ibu sekalian, karena waktu sudah selesai, kita akan
Pak Fidel lagi. Pak Fidel, izin tanya untuk tadi saya wakili teman-teman peserta, ada bertanya, ada enggak?
Oke, pertanyaan terakhir, silakan.
Untuk anu, bukan pertanyaan Pak Sanipar, ini cuma teman-teman bertanya. Ini link absen, adakah yang harus di meeting ini, pertemuan kita ini atau tidak ada Pak? Link absen peserta.
Ya,
silakan Pak.
Ya, sebenarnya kalau pada saat apa undangan dibuatkan itu ada form registrasi yang ada QR code-nya. Nah, kemudian yang kedua, feedback form, mengisi feedback form itu adalah salah satu metodologi absennya, Pak. Gitu. Terima kasih.
Oke, jelas Pak, dilanjut.
Baik, Bapak Ibu sekalian, Pak Zanibar, kita akhiri belum webinar kali ini karena sudah waktunya. Terima kasih kepada Bapak Ibu sekalian, terutama kepada narasumber kita dari jam 8 tadi, kepada pelaksana tugas Tuan Gus Kantin, Pak Hasan Khabibi yang mengucapkan terima kasih, lalu kepada Miss Julia Yang, lalu Pak Zanibar dan juga Pak Indra Karismiaji. Dan perlu kami sampaikan permohonan maaf karena ada tugas dan kegiatan lain Pak Indra, makanya leave duluan sehingga saya mengendal di akhir acara ini. Jadi sekali lagi saya mengucapkan terima kasih kepada Bapak Ibu sekalian yang sudah terlibat di webinar kali ini. Salam sehat selalu untuk kita, untuk segala materinya, dan disampaikan lewat email dari masing-masing peserta. Baik, terima kasih dan mohon maaf. Salam sehat selalu untuk kita semua.
Ya, terima kasih Pak Fidel. Terima kasih Bapak Ibu semuanya.